As Robinson comes in, bowls. It's bowling! With a yorker. Brilliant. Under the bat, Khwaja's bowled for 141. His off stumps uprooted.
So Boland is running in. Crawley's on the walk and he's beaten. He's nicked it. He's out. I think he's on the way. They're very confident. The finger has not gone, but Crawley's gone. He's walking now. He's out, caught behind. Australia get another wicket.
England are reduced to 28 for 2, so they lead by 35. We'll hear from Ollie Robinson and Alex Carey, and there'll be analysis from Jason Gillespie, Michael Vaughan and Sir Alistair Cook.
The TMS Podcast.
Keep up to date with live text and highlights during the match on the BBC Sport website and app.
The close of play, England 28 for 2. They sauntered their way, really, to 27 for no wicket. The storm clouds gathered, the ball started to move around. The Australians, having set defensive fields again, suddenly woke up to the fact, hang on a minute, the ball might move around a bit here. So Pat Cummins got the players in, he got some close fielders up, and sure enough, before you knew it, Ben Duckett was brilliantly caught by Green. He's just got his telescoping arms at fine gully, low to his left. This one is a fantastic catch off Cummins for 19. And the next over, Crawley edged Boland to Carey for 7. So 27 for no wicket, 27 for 2. And very, very awkward conditions indeed for Pope and Root to survive. And they haven't scored any runs, but they have at least come away now with England leading by 35 and with 8 wickets left. Just to throw that into the mix, that on his birthday, Moeen Ali's got a nasty finger injury to his spinning finger. Raw skin there, it's like a blister has come off or something like that. It's worn away. And that is not going to be something that's going to help him bowl Australia out in the fourth innings, which you'd be hoping that an off-spinner might do in these circumstances. So we'll keep an eye on that. I'm sure they're working on that finger at this very moment. So, lots to talk about. Australia losing their last 5 for 75 earlier on today. Some fascinating tactics again employed by Ben Stokes, and as usual, as is his way at the moment, they worked as well. So we'll talk about all of that sort of business to start with, at least with we've got Dizzy as well, Jason Gillespie, that's great, Michael Vaughan and Alistair Cook sitting down at the end there. Who should we start with? Let's get an Australian voice to start with, shall we? Jason, because there they were, that started that second innings, England pottering along, they didn't seem to be under any pressure at all. Storm clouds come in, it starts to rain all around, and Pat Cummins suddenly seemed to think, hang on, the ball might swing around a bit here. Got the field in, bang, bang.
Yeah, I was really impressed with Pat bringing Nathan. I remember jumping for joy because he actually brought the deep point.
But he had to, didn't he?
He had to, but yeah. It was obviously too late. Thought he would have learned some lessons from the first innings because, again, it started. There just didn't seem to be that intent and look to take wickets, almost like, let's just wait and see what happens instead of being proactive. And but then, as you said, the storm clouds come in. All of a sudden, it looked a different surface, didn't it? The bowlers looked a half a yard quicker and created a little bit of indecision with the England batters. Yeah, it's going to be an interesting start tomorrow. England only, 35 in front. A couple of wickets early doors. There'll be a bit of panic in that dressing room.
Definitely. And batting in those sort of circumstances. I mean, you just want to get off, don't you, Michael? Looking at the umpire saying, come on, I can't see anything out here. and it is a different game for a while.
You try everything you can to delay it. But, you know, there's times that, you know, you have to change the way that you play. You know, Test cricket is the hardest format because you get challenged. And, you know, I don't know of any player in the history of the game that's just had one way of playing. You know, if you want to survive at this level, when the clouds come in, you have to have the ability. If you're an aggressive player and you're a stroke maker, you have to have the ability to realise that there may only be 15 minutes left, so 2 or 3 overs, 4 overs max, and you have to just try and see that through. And if that means leaving the ball, so Ben Duckett's not left a ball in the test match. He's been out twice, caught behind. And that was a moment for me where, you know, they looked like they were going off. So it's not hard, easy as a batter. You know, you're kind of going through the emotions. Oh, you want to be off, but, you know, you have to stay. And he was kind of looking around. And all of a sudden, he plays a really poor stroke, Ben Duckett. You know, that was why. That was just a jab. He has to believe in that delivery. And, yes, he likes to own channel. He likes to go at the bowler. But in that situation, he has to be able to change his game and go to plan B. He's like, I've got to be here in 15 minutes' time. And if that means I have to change the way that I play, he's going to have to do that. Then you go down the other end and Scott Boland was just in one of those spells. It always reminded me of that spell in Melbourne where it looked like he was going to get a wicket every ball. And he gets the ball from, to Zach Crawley. He comes out of his crease, tries to get his legs out of side of off stump and defends the ball. I don't think it does a great deal. You know, I don't think it's seen that much. And he gets the feather through to the keeper. And at that period, you felt that Australia were going to get a wicket every single ball. But, you know, it was great drama of Test match cricket. I think over the course of the 3 days, we've had tremendous theatre. The first ball from Crawley, the first evening, Warner and Broad, that contest for 20 minutes. And that period there for about 20 minutes where we knew it was going to rain. And Australia finally became Australia. You know, so far in this Test match, they've been very unlike Australia in terms of their body language, their aggression out in the outfield on day one was something that I've never seen. It wasn't there. And when England came and got to 26 for naught, I think it was the easiest 26 runs I've seen an England team get against an Australian seed. 13 singles out of the 26. Just easy, just rotating the strike. Nathan Lyon came on, the field was spread. And I think that break there when England were 26 for naught was the pivotal moment, because Australia came out, the clouds were around, and they suddenly went to their aggression and three or four slips, and Pat Cummins started to hit his length and Scott Boland started to hit his length, and all of a sudden we were watching going, wait a minute, Australia have arrived, and I'll be amazed if they don't come out and do that again tomorrow.
Yeah, you'd think so. You'd have left that delivery cookie, there's no doubt about that. I mean, it's all very well for Duckett to have this record of leaving 1% of the balls that he faces, but if you are going to succeed as an opening batsman, you're not going to be wanted to... I mean, it was a brilliant catch. Don't get nothing away from him. But he really had no business nudging at that, really, did he, at that stage?
I think he'll be more annoyed, not with the leaving, not leaving it, but how timid and tentative he jabbed at it or poked at it. If he's not leaving the ball...
What's the alternative, then? You swish at it?
Well, or you play his strong cut shot.
Yeah.
Not an easy shot to play at all to Pat Cummins, who had been actually bringing the ball back in to Ben Duckett from around the wicket. This one was more traditional going away. So he could have actually cut it, or, you know, his front foot shot. I think he'll be more annoyed that he... You know, probably with the weather in his mind, that was him being defensive. That was him trying to soak up the pressure. I would rather have him played a cut shot to get out rather than just an indecisive poke at the ball, because, you know, he's all well and good saying, you know, you need to leave the ball. He doesn't leave the ball. So that's adding something else back into a game, which he hasn't been doing for a long period of time.
Yeah.
Whether we're sitting here saying, well, he needs to leave the ball, he wants to be more successful, that's for him to work out. But in his mind, he's very clear and has been very clear so far since going back into this England team. I'm not leaving the ball. I'm looking to play everything. So that is how his method of going about things. I was more like, I think he'll be more frustrated how timid he was then.
I think, though, I guess if you look at where Ben Duckett has batted, he's batted in Pakistan on flat wickets where the ball doesn't do a great deal, and you can own channel. New Zealand, the ball didn't do a great deal. You can own channel. And then you come to the UK against Ireland, where their attack really was a nice attack to face, where you can own channel. Against great bowlers, you know, I would put Pat Cummins in the great category. He's going to be an all-time great when he finishes. You have to have the ability to see the ball through to the keeper.
Yeah.
You have to as an opening batsman. Well,
this has always been the question for me with Duckett, and I'm surprised at the very defensive fields they've set for him there, because he looks like a sort of two gullies man for me. But if he were to come to you, Alistair, as a, you know, another left-handed opening batsman, and say, what do you think? Would you say to him, I really believe, Ben, that you've got to start lining up that off stump, and you've got to let some balls go?
Well, me and Vaughan were talking about this, you know, a couple of hours ago.
It puts pressure on the bowler too. I mean, if there's a batsman that keeps leaving you, you have to adjust your line.
When you look back at most of the time of your career, when I was really struggling, what did I do? I went away from what was natural to me. I changed my technique. I was trying to improve, and actually this improvement of my technique, which I thought was the right thing to do, was wrong. And I wish I never did fiddle with my technique, because it caused me all kinds of aggro. Talk about Ollie Pope in the last Ashes series. He said he changed his technique mid-series. He had different theories. He wished he didn't do it. So advice during a series, I actually think I wouldn't go down that route, because that's changing how he plays. Whether at the end of this series, he needs to, if he thinks, right, I'm against the best bowling in the world, I need to change my game plan, then that's probably the best way. I would rather him just say, no, right, I am going to play the way I have done so far, and be, just be better at playing those shots.
Look at bowler's perspective then, Jason. Go on. If you have Duckett, who I say leaves 1% of what you bowl at him, what are you thinking as an opening bowler, and you're bowling to him? Are you going to bowl it a little bit wider and keep him chasing it, but then you do bring in his cut shot then?
I'd probably be tighter on that off stump, fourth stump. Encourage him to play, and then look, the odd one, drag him away.
Right.
Pretty much what Hazelwood did that first innings. It was tight, hang, see if he'll take the bait. That would be probably my plan A. And then you start, part of your plan A might be, okay, what angle do I want? Do I want to go over the wicket, or do I want to have a look around the wicket? And then you observe what he's doing at that end. Does he change his stance? Does he change where he stands? Is he coming further out? Is he getting across his stumps? And then you just look to mess with their feet, mess with their technique, mess with their head. How's he holding the bat? Is he choking it here? Does that indicate that he's looking to impact the shorter ball as opposed to the fuller one? Because if they start grabbing bottom hand a little bit harder, then you're going to, okay, I can probably err on the fuller side here because he's waiting for the shorter ball. So I'm going to look to go maybe a little bit fuller. So just these little clues you get, batsmen always give you a clue. You just got to find that clue.
Yeah.
The TMS Podcast. How to win the Ashes. The untold stories of three key Ashes series is available now on BBC iPlayer.
I just didn't want to let my family down, so that's why I sort of like push myself every single day.
Jermaine Defoe, Outside the Box, from BBC Radio 5 Live.
Join me for my brand new Fly on the Wall podcast in my quest to become a football manager.
Just being able to look yourself in the mirror every day and just be like, you know what? I did everything right, I didn't cut any corners.
From my roots in East London to 57 England caps, winning the Scottish Premier League and everything in between.
The gift and the talent, that takes care of itself, but the hard work and the sort of like application, this needs to be day in and day out.
Jermaine Defoe, Outside the Box. Listen on BBC Sounds.
It's interesting when Joe Root was batting, wasn't it? It came out, it was really difficult. On the one hand, as an England supporter, you're thinking that is the last person I want to see batting in these conditions and having to survive. On the other hand, you're thinking, well, actually, there's no one better to get in there with Root's attitude and temperament and, of course, his ability to be out there to try and steer England through those very dicey few minutes.
They were dicey. It's his ability, isn't it? His ability to play the situation. You've been saying about Ben Duckett, he needs to change his game. Zach Crawley, adapt his game. You know, we've got the best person in our team who I've seen being able to change his game according to the situation, with such a limited change to his technique. It's all about just changing his tempo. And I think that's such a big skill. If I had to play one day cricket, I almost had to stand wider, you know, change my game totally. Joe Root just decides which strike rate he can strike at. And here, you know, we knew he weren't going to play his big shots. He would have gone, but he was still looking busy to try and get off strike, because that's how he wants to play and that's his best method of survival. But he's such a good player.
But also, Cookie, to someone like Boland, the real threat to Boland is that ball that nips back to the right-hander. So Joe Root, what did he do? Just comes out of his crease, yeah, Makes sure his pads are outside the line of off stump, and if it does nip back, it hit him outside the line of off stump. So I heard the terminology problem solving a lot into the modern game. You know, Steve Smith, they say, is the best problem solver. That, you know, Justin Langer said to me last week, he said he's the best problem solver that he's ever seen.
Right.
You know, he just knows how to work out the problem. And that's what all I say to someone like Ben Duckett, you know, don't just be a one-trick pony. Now, there are times, and only small times, you know, in the UK in the last year or so in Test match cricket, the ball has done nothing like what it used to do.
Mm.
So there's only these small windows where suddenly the ball just starts to move a little bit. Don't just gif your wicket away. Just be a problem solver in that period. And today it was just for 20 minutes.
Mm.
20 minutes. And for Ben Duckett to be playing Test match cricket in 3, 4, 5, 6 years' time, he can't just play one way.
No.
And that's all I'll say to him, be aggressive when you can. But when you get into that period like you got today and you could see the clouds rolling in, just be a better problem solver.
A bit of common sense, really,
yes,
Isn't it? I mean, there are times you're going to have to fight.
How did you adapt? Because you were a stroke player, weren't you? You looked to always be positive. When did you, what was your method of changing? Because my method would always be, how quickly I started. Do you know what I mean? Like, if I would be playing myself in and then kind of just, no, not, I wouldn't go through the gears, but I'd stay at that kind of same kind of tempo. And if I found that tempo, brilliant, and that's how I batted. Obviously, if we needed quicker runs or whatever, I could change it a little bit. But, you know, I was a very different player to you. I looked to soak up pressure and bat a long period of time, where, you know, you, certainly against Australia, when you play your absolute best, you did take the...
I think your strike rate was better than mine, Cookie, to
no.
No.
I think it is. Honestly, over the whole... there was periods in my career where I was pretty boring. There was periods where I was quite aggressive. I actually used to look
at... Cookies is always boring, though.
I used to look at the clock. I used to look at the clock and just give myself 10-minute spells. So I'd look at the clock and think, right, I want to be there at 10 past. Deliver the process, keep delivering the process, the routine, try and be there at 10 past, get to 10 past, and try and be there at 20 past, and just deliver it that way. And also, just try and read the game. You know, it's like gameplay. You know, try and work out what is the best thing for the team at this position. Do they need me to be aggressive, or do they need me just to fight through? And that's all I say to someone like Ben is, just realise sometimes you just got to bat for the team. Just bat for that moment and just get in. The dressing room, we all know when it's starting to swing around, the clouds are on. It's horrible in the dressing room. Mm. And you're next in, you're nervous. So you've just got to try and play that moment. And it's only a small moment, exactly how the team need you to play it.
The most frustrating answer I get from an England batsman is, well, that's the way I play. And that winds me up, actually, as a bowler. because
is it a cop-out? I mean,
it feels like it is. I mean, as a bowler, when you're sitting in the dressing room there and all these horrible fast bowlers are running in and bowling, actually, you know, you are relying on the batsman to get out there and not get out to them. But so if they play a rubbish shot, and that's
a brilliant
the way I play.
Point, because if you actually look at England's bowlers in this test match, Anderson, Broaden and Jimmy Anderson, what are they? Pitch-up seam bowlers, wobble seam bowlers, swing bowlers. But what did the team require?
Yeah.
So, well, sure.
They bowl very unselfishly.
They change their game plan.
Yeah.
You know, so they've got plans B, plan C. You know, you can't just have a plan A as a batter.
No.
You can't. You've got to have those.
Do you agree
gears.
My natural game and being that's the way I play is being a bit of a frustration.
Yeah. No. But I'm talking about a different England style to what Ben Stokes is imploring his side to play like. So I agree. I do think you have to adapt, and at certain times you have to forgo that half volley. You know, there, that last 10 balls, if I was batting there, I would have just thinking, right, survival is the only thing I'm thinking about. I'm not thinking, even if I got a short and wide cut ball, I'm not taking it on. It's one of, you know, my only scoring shot, as you keep mentioning to me. I would have had to have let that go. Yeah. Like, it's interesting to see, like, if would Vaughan have thought like that? You know, if he had got half volley of Pat Cummins there with your cover drive, which is one of your main scores, would you have played it?
No, I'm thinking off stump. If it's under my nose and it can go down the ground, of course, just lean on it. But try and nullify. I used to think of my right eye. So when it got really tough or you're just trying to survive, anything outside the line of the right eye, it's got to go. Just let it go through to the keeper. Just try and play the ball right in the middle of the head and let it come as close as possible. And if you get a beauty, you get a beauty.
And as a double centurion...
I don't know why I kept asking Vaughan.
I know. Did you change your natural game? Is he?
I didn't really have a natural game. I literally, when I was batting, it was all about survival, because a lot of the time I'm batting with a batter. So I just tried to stay in. It was as simple as that. I know, not sure how that sounds, but I literally just tried to survive. And if I could get down the other end, beautiful.
Yeah. Well, even Agger's in the Bazball era, and the way that they've played in the last half is great entertainment. We've all loved it. But
yes, definitely.
If Ben Duckett had have walked into that dressing room, not out, and he'd have left five or six, I bet you'd have got big fist pump. He really would have, because all the team would have got brilliant, Ben, well played.
Yeah,
even in the Bazball era,
I agree with you.
They would have all gone brilliant, well played.
Yeah, because
he adapted, adjusted his game to the team
sense.
Needs.
Because he can come back tomorrow and get back to Bazballing.
Exactly.
You don't have to Bazball all the time.
No.
Just for we're only asking, and we're not asking for a great deal. The odd 20 minutes, The odd three or four overs, where it just starts to get a little bit tricky, and the
clouds are rolling in.
Yeah, just please, just try and put Bazball just into a little bag, and then bring it out when that little period ends.
Yeah, let's talk about this extraordinary dismissal of Khawaja. I don't know. I mean, the idea is we see Stokes, the captain, doing a lot of unusual, unorthodox things. Like keeping the field up, we know, and when you know, beyond the time where most people, I think, would have actually put someone back for mowing, and what happens, he gets a wicket. This is a very flat pitch, an obdurate, determined, fine player like Khawaja is clearly difficult to get out when you've got quite a one-dimensional attack. So what does he do? He first of all constructed a wall in the leg side of three fielders, or was it four actually? It was four to start with, for a few balls, and then he moved one of them across to the offside where he constructed another field of three. So there were then three fielders on either side, like the old-fashioned umbrella field, wasn't it? They used to have at school. And that was because the kids haven't got the strength to hit it through, so they have a little umbrella field up, and it's very difficult.
It's like the field, you know, the game Test Match, especially where you used to roll the ball down, and you used to have the field as a...
Absolutely.
That was the field.
Impossible to score, really. And he set it to a fellow on about 130, who'd faced the best part of 300 balls. And it just seemed to do his head in. He had Robinson bowling his cutters, and then he bowled a normal speed ball. This is the clever bit as well. Khawaja was anticipating a cutter, gave himself a little bit of room. Bang, a full speed Yorker knocked his off stump out of the ground.
Yeah, I'd like to speak to Ollie Robinson, because the plan was brilliant, it's genius. But that ability as a bowler, and Jason and you, Agus, could tell, do you think that Ollie Robinson was running in thinking faster ball because the field's set for the cutter? Or do you think he's seen Khawaja just dance down, or there's something that he's seen that he's thinking, wait a minute, Khawaja's doing something, he's coming at me here, and he just gave himself a little bit of room on the leg side, a hit through the offside, and he's fired in that Yorker. Do you think he's running and thinking faster ball, or just at the last minute he's seen Khawaja just do something different, and he's gone, all right, I'll just fire it in?
Grip would be interesting, wouldn't it? Was he holding a grip, I wonder, for the off-cutter when he ran in, because it had to have changed.
That's what we'd have to probably have a look at if we saw a replay, but I think there'd be occasions where both those scenarios would happen. He's probably thinking cutter. He may have a plan of the over in advance, going, I'm going to go cutter, cutter, cutter. Then I'm going to go quicker ball, anticipating that Usman might just look to give himself some room. But yeah, I think Agus's point, if we saw what his grip was coming in and he adjusted, if he saw Usman moving early enough, I think Ollie Robinson, having observed him bowl over a number of years, I think he's good enough to adjust. Mm. He's got an excellent Yorker. He's always had an excellent Yorker.
And credit to Khawaja, because actually I think he was taking the right option, because if the cutter came, he was just going to launch it over the six fielder's head. So it was the right approach.
Well, I think part of Ben Stokes is captaincy, and he always says, we just want to go and enjoy ourselves. They tried everything against Khawaja. 300 odd balls and nothing was working on the
wicket.
And I reckon he got to the stage, so if anyone knows what Joss Butler writes on the top of his bat in a one day game, I think they got to that stage in the field against him, and then they thought, they kind of came at this plan, I'm going to bowl leg stump cutters and half volleys with all those men on the leg side, he might chip one in the air, and then the plan kind of evolved again, why don't we just do it offside as well. The skill of just going, having the ability to go, well, it doesn't matter now because he's doing so well. Ollie Robinson being able to back it up by bowling those cutters as well on a length. So he didn't give anything easy for Khawaja just to knock it past them. Was excellent. And then I think he's bowling Yorker or whatever. I don't think he saw Khawaja coming, in my opinion. What was it, the skill of it was nailing his Yorker. And every time he bowled a Yorker in that spell, he absolutely nailed it.
Do you think in the modern era of so many coaches, of everything... that what Stokes is doing is he's totally challenging the traditional coaching method. So in other words, you batsmen are coached, and because you're fine players, you also you are used to playing in a certain way, certain fields. You know that if you play that particular shot a couple of times, there'll be a fielder there. You know as a bowler that if you beat the bat a couple of times, you might bring another slip in. Or whatever it may be, if you're playing a sweep lot, you'll put someone there. But when you're suddenly confronted with the sort of stuff that Stokes is throwing at you, totally unconventional, it sort of scramble your brain a bit.
Yeah, I mean, I remember when I was captain years ago, there was times in the field where I got a bit bored, and I would put fielders in positions just because I was a bit bored.
I used to call him Claudio Ranieri, the Tinker Man, because you're always tinkering the field.
Because I was thinking, wait a minute, what would I like as a batter? Probably conventional, I'm in. So I used to try and just create something to just get in the batter's mind. It worked on the odd occasion, but 90% of the time it didn't work, because it was just ridiculous. Yep. But what I was trying to do, and what I wanted the team to try and do, and I think Ben's doing it now brilliantly, is you're just trying to say to the batter, do you have a clue what we're doing? Because I don't really know. You know, it's almost like you're bluffing them, really.
Yes.
And just, as you say, the conventional way of playing cricket has been with us for a long, long time. And yes, you're in your stanchion, you generally see three slips in a gully and a backward point, mid-off, mid-on, square leg goes back every now and again. And you go, oh, that's what you see. But
well, very familiar.
If all of a sudden you see two or three catches in front of you and a mid-wicket, and Steve Smith yesterday, when he went out to bat, he had four conventional slips, two leg slips. I don't think Steve Smith would have seen that before.
No.
You know, so
and then he had Harry Brook bowling at him as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, I'm not too sure about that. But, you know, I think there's certainly a method in the madness.
And what did it do? It took Khawaja out of his rhythm.
Exactly.
He had not charged Moinalli, of course, not charged a seamer, didn't need to, was just picking off ill, and he changed the way Khawaja played.
Yeah. I'm going to ask you both the same question I asked you last night. I mean, do you sit there and think, wow, this is genius? You know, both having been, you know, very successful captains in your time. You know, thinking, why didn't I think of that sometimes when someone was 200 not out or something? Do you find yourselves thinking that?
What I like about the whole leadership, it's so clear, and this is the way he's decided he wants to captain, and he's sticking to it. And that's all you want. You know, of a player, you want to follow someone who's like that. So the field placings, a lot of the time, as Vaughan said, just you have a little feel most of the time. It's just a bit of luck. That was a luck that he what happened in one sense. You know, that those six fielders, yeah, you know, were almost irrelevant. What he was doing was putting Khawaja on the game. I just love the way he is kind of just taking the shackles off captaincy, and that's what I've really enjoyed about his captaincy.
The best thing about Ben's captaincy is that if you watch him and study him out in the outfield, whatever he does, whatever field he sets, every single member of the team just move. They never doubt what he's doing. And even when he put the six in place, you know, it's never been done before. And usually you'd have a few people chuckling,
yes, and
laugh. They just get on with it. You know, they're almost saying, we know he's doing this the right, you know, for the team. We believe in him. You know, there's no body language that drops, or there's no moment where you see two fielders going against him. I can't believe he's doing this, can you? They're all right behind whatever he's doing. They trust him. He's got that. I think it was Baz McCullum said, oh, he's a lucky captain. You know, I don't know what really Baz means by that, but he probably means by he's just got that Midas touch. Beefy Beaufort, when he used to bowl,
yeah,
bowl
sure,
some absolute filth, get wickets. Yep. Ben Stokes has got whatever it is that you require to have that element of fortune that goes your way as a captain. He's absolutely got it.
Do you know the one thing that they should do to improve it if they do that wall again?
To Khawaja.
To anybody. Three in your face there. Three in your face there, bucket hats. They should all be wearing bucket hats.
Yes.
And they should stand there, don't you think?
Yeah. But it's the kind of thing that Ben and the team, because they play in such a different way, is they'll say, oh, Khawaja's got a weakness to that. We'll start with that in the second innings.
I think they just stand there with bucket hats on. Right, Moeen, what do we think about this? Because that actually has a big impact potentially on England's prospect in this match. It certainly, I would suggest, means they've got to score more runs, if they possibly can, in this innings, because that finger looks horrible.
Yeah, nasty. As I'm sure people know, he's got a horrible blister on his spinning finger, and that will only just get sore and sore as you grip the ball. You know, I spoke to Simon Harmer, you know, our off-spin at Essex. What do you do? He bowls a huge amount of overs, and he suggested a change of grip, you know, to try and spin off a different part of your finger, which I assume he does at certain times when his finger gets sore. A few oils and ointments that you can put on, but it's tough. It is tough, and that's a real hammer blow in one sense for England, because Moeen's the attacking bowler. If England have only got 230 runs, 240 runs to play with, you know, Moeen does go for runs. Mm. Whether Joe Root could bowl a bit more of a holding role, very un-Ben Stokes captaincy, but he is adaptable. So Joe Root will have to bowl more to left hand, more holding, a tie and end up, and then attack in those unconventional ways with the seamers the other end.
Our spin expert, Mr. Tufnell, he says urine.
Oh yes, yes. Well, that goes back to back in the day. Yeah, I know. That's why you should never, never ever shake an off spinner by the hand.
That's an old
wives' tale. It's an old spinner's tale.
Yeah, we've got to be honest. That's going to be a problem.
Yeah,
that's going to be a real problem, because, you know, when you've got such a sore right index finger, and it's right in the part that Moeen gets the revolutions on the ball. And we saw him bowl today. You know, we saw him bowl the balls, you know, those full tight. We didn't see any of those yesterday. He bowled beautifully, and today it was either his body was really tired, but it's got to be to do with that cut on his finger. How quickly they repair, again, probably Simon Harmer's the one to ask, but I can't imagine he's going to be anywhere near 100% for that second innings. And it might be a doubt going forward because, you know, give it a week and the skin will come back. But as soon as you start bowling once again, you know, it's just going to get ripped off.
You've got to
once
say,
more. He's had problems. Because I mean, he's had problems in the past with it. And this was always going to be the problem for someone that's not been used to bowling such an amount of overs.
Yeah.
Either his body or his finger was going to pretty much say, I'm sorry, but it's not possible to bowl that amount of overs without having played a lot of cricket. So I do think that's a major concern for England.
Do you think anyone would have considered that? Given the fact that he hasn't even playing such, you know, short form cricket, was it always going to be a risk that this might happen? I mean, he bowled a lot of overs in that first.
Yeah, I don't think they specifically think he's going to get a blister on his finger, but I think they must have thought that he's only been playing franchise cricket, so that there is an element of risk. But I'm guessing management would have thought, you know what, experience, the fact that he's played a lot of first-class cricket, he should be able to tick-tack straight back into that, no dramas. You know, they'd assess the risk v reward, and I think they felt that his experience was the reward.
Yeah, I don't think they envisaged he'd bowled 30-odd overs. I thought, you know, they wanted a harder, faster wicket than that they've got here. So I don't think they would have thought he would have bowled 33 overs.
It's intriguing, though, isn't it? We're 3 days into the Ashes, and already you can see, you know, if this goes really well for England, they're going to be absolutely fine. If the next 2 days don't go well for England, the drums are already beating about the keeper. Do they need Ben Folkes in?
Yeah.
Do they replace someone at the top of the order to bring Folkes in? The spinner, was it right to pick someone that's not played for 2 years? So I think these next 2 days are going to be so important for the momentum and the noise around this Ashes series. And I think it has to go the way of England, because there's more, you know, question marks really with what's happened with England. I think Australia...
That goes to Aussie tactics, isn't it? The Aussie tactics have been defensive, which they have been, but if they get the result at the end, Pat Cummins will stand there and say the tactics worked.
Now, I'm going to welcome someone to to the sort of seat that he might be occupying in maybe 15 years' time. This is where the retired, broken bodies of old fast bowlers come and sit, Ollie Robinson, and it's a much easier job up here.
Yes, definitely.
Sit here and you just see the game.
Definitely less wear and tear on the body, isn't it?
There is less wear and tear. It's very nice to see you. Welcome to Test Match Special.
Thank you very much.
It's lovely to have you on. And reflect on, well, look, let's go straight in for it. Let's go for that Khawaja dismissal. With that field, the only thing that was missing, we felt from the fielders in those positions, were the bucket hats. That would have kind of completed the picture. But where did that come from?
We were searching, obviously, all yesterday afternoon, trying to get a plan to Khawaja on the slow wicket to make him play a shot, really. He obviously prefers to play the ball off the back foot, and on a slow wicket, it's a lot easier for him. Stokes said this morning, let's go back to Pakistan and sort of try and recreate those fields, try and get him to play shots that he's not comfortable to. So I think before that ball, he said, let's go back to Rawalpindi, Pakistan, umbrella field. And then he said, just mix it up, slow balls, Yorkers. And the ball just started to tail a little bit. Obviously, we bowled bumpers before that, so there's a little bit of reverse. So I just went for the Yorker, and luckily paid off.
So you did go for the Yorker from the start. It wasn't, you didn't see him advance or move. That was going to be the Yorker, and you nailed it.
Yeah, just been practicing a bit of T20 recently, so I went for the Yorker, and it came off.
But you do have a very good record at it coming off, isn't it? And it's not an easy ball to bowl.
No, it's... I suppose as cricketers these days, you have to be ready for all formats. And I think in this case, it's helped me in Test cricket. Yeah. So it's nice that it came off to see, and saw the off stump flying.
How was it in that really dicey period there with the storms gathering and those two wickets falling? I mean, even in that relaxed dressing room, it must have been a bit anxious, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was sort of the first time we saw the pitch really zip about a little bit in 3 days. I think the lights and the overheads obviously gave it a bit of carry, a bit of pace, a bit of nip. We still wanted to play the same way as we have been playing, but obviously you have to sort of submit to conditions sometimes. And I think if we'd carried on batting, you might have seen a slightly different approach, but I think we still would have been positive in our movements and in our defence.
Yeah. Have you got any idea in your head, Ollie, as to what is a good score to put out on there for the Australians to chase in the fourth innings?
It feels like a wicket where if you have to attack, it's actually quite hard to score. I think with the three bowlers that we have plus Mo, it's, and Stokes, obviously the enforcer, it's quite hard to score against us. We set straight fields and bowl straight at their batters. They're not going to find it easy to score. So we feel like anything over 300, we're right in the game. Obviously, taking wickets is another issue, but hopefully we can create 10 chances and win the game.
Yeah. And what about Moeen? Just a last thought. I mean, have you seen his finger? Is it a bit of a mess by the look of the pictures we've seen?
I haven't actually seen it. So I think by all accounts, it will be fine. I think it's one of those things, isn't it? Sometimes you get little niggles or little tears in the skin and you just crack on. That's Test cricket and playing for your country.
Yeah. And positive? I mean, you really think you can win this game?
Yeah, I do. I think we've got a lot of cricket left. Hopefully the pitch deteriorates a bit more. Hopefully it will go down probably more than up. And hopefully we can get the ball moving on the last day if we can bat all day tomorrow.
Well, that's lovely to have Ollie Robinson joining us in the TMS commentary box. We can get an Australian perspective now from the wicketkeeper, Alex Carey.
Well, Alex, thrilling test match. Where do you see it?
Yeah, good question. I think it's pretty evenly poised. We would have liked to go past England's first inning score, but taking a couple of wickets tonight obviously is a great feeling for the change room. So yeah, it's going to be a matter of rocking up tomorrow morning and trying to get one of these quality batters out and continue to chip away at the England lineup.
How desperate were you to see the umpires say, yeah, go and have another half an hour in these conditions?
Yeah, we would have liked to get back out there. Obviously it's never nice, I guess, going out when the lights are on and it's almost past bedtime to get out there. But yeah, it's the unique thing about England. You can play really late, which is awesome. But yeah, as a bowling group, you want to continue on, you know, that couple of wickets and, you know, not much to gain in sort of 30 minutes of cricket.
It felt like that 20-minute period where those two wickets fell. It felt like Test cricket at its most intense.
Yeah, it felt like that out there too. We're obviously really keen to stay out there and try to take more wickets. We, again, two quality players at the crease in Pope and Root, and would be nice to get another one. Unfortunately, yeah, the rain set in and that was day done. But yeah, it's going to be just as exciting tomorrow.
What about this surface? Been a lot of talk about it. How's it behaving out there?
Oh, look, I think, as I mentioned before, I think when bowlers can stick to a plan or shift to a different plan, hit that hard length for, you know, a long enough period with the right fields, it's hard to score. It's there's still enough there reacting off the wicket at times, and if you can get the ball swinging a little bit as well, there's certainly enough in it there for the quicks. And then for spin, we've seen balls spin past the bat. You know, a number of wickets have fallen to spin already, and we're, you know, sort of 2 days in. So yeah, I think the wickets, it's playing pretty solid. We saw 390 runs on day one and another 300 today with, you know, five wickets there as well. So, yeah, I think it's exciting.
Ashes cricket is an intense thing. Front of the Holly stand as well. It's noisy out there. But what about the Ollie Robinson send-off for Usman Khawaja? There's been quite a lot of talk about that since it happened.
Yeah, I actually didn't realise it happened like that, and Uzi hasn't said anything. So, yeah, there's nothing from the Aussies there. But in terms of the stand, I think Travis Head will go home tonight with his ears ringing, standing out in front of them, and might come with some earmuffs tomorrow. But I think it's creating a great atmosphere. And at times when you're standing out there, you can't help yourself to hum along to some of the tunes and sing along. And as players, we absolutely love the atmosphere.
Just finally, have you thought in your mind how many would be okay and how many would be too many?
I don't really know. I think the wickets still, if you lock in and patient, as we saw Uzi, there's opportunities to score and bat lots of time. And as a bowling group, like I said, if you've got your plans and you stick to them long enough or change, there's opportunities there. So I haven't put a number on it. I think overnight there'll be some chitter chatter on the bus, as there always is, but for us it's not worrying too much about that. We know the game can move quickly in either direction, so yeah, I think it's a big first hour tomorrow.